The Hidden History of Christmas, Bible and Pagans. We are looking at the history of Christmas and its pagan origins, and how this all connects to the biblical story of Jesus' birth. How could this even be possible? Although Christmas may look like a pure Christian holiday, just recently it was not so. In fact, it was just the opposite. We will seek to uncover the true depths of how influential pagan cultures is still influencing the world. And we will uncover to you all the surprising truths that we found. To understand the roots of Christmas, we need to travel back in time, long before the birth of Christ. Imagine ancient Europe. Cold, dark, and harsh winters ruled the land. Life wasn't easy, and every year, people faced a daunting challenge, making it through the season of scarcity. But amidst the struggle, there was hope. Hope that the sun, their source of life and warmth, would return stronger. This hope gave birth to traditions we still see today. In the northern regions, the celebration of Yule marked the winter solstice. On the darkest night of the year, they lit massive bonfires to honor the sun and keep its memory alive. Families brought home enormous logs, the famous Yule logs, and kept them burning as a symbol of light overcoming darkness. Sound familiar? That's the origin of the Yule log tradition we hear about today. Meanwhile, in southern Europe, the Romans celebrated their own midwinter festival, Saturnalia. This was a grand event dedicated to Saturn, the god of agriculture. It marked the end of the harvest and the beginning of winter rest. But Saturnalia was no quiet religious observance. It was a full-blown carnival. During Saturnalia, social norms were flipped upside down. Masters and slaves traded places, and the streets were filled with laughter, singing, and celebration. Homes were decorated with greenery. People feasted until they couldn't eat another bite. And yes, they even gave gifts, just like we do today. Many of the decorations we associate with Christmas, holly, mistletoe, and wreaths, come from these ancient traditions. They symbolized life and fertility during the bleakest time of year. But there's more to the story. In both the Northern Yule and the Roman Saturnalia, these festivals weren't just about survival. They were about letting loose, breaking free from the rules of daily life. And sometimes, this freedom went too far. These celebrations could get wild. It was a time to indulge in food, drink, and, well, other behaviors that wouldn't be considered appropriate the rest of the year. Some of this still survives today. Ever heard of kissing under the mistletoe? That's an echo of these ancient fertility customs. As Christianity spread, these celebrations didn't disappear. Instead, they were transformed. The church had a choice. Reject these beloved traditions or give them a new meaning. What happened next would change the course of history and the way we celebrate Christmas forever. The decorations we use today also have roots in these pagan festivals. Evergreens like holly and mistletoe were symbols of life and fertility. Mistletoe especially carried a sacred meaning. It was believed to have magical properties, bringing health, protection, and blessings. Over time, it became a symbol of love. This was the ultimate indulgence, a time to eat, drink, and be merry without worrying about tomorrow. Sound familiar? Today, we carry on this tradition with Christmas feasts. The turkey, the desserts, and even the over-the-top portions all harken back to these ancient festivals. But in those days, it wasn't just about joy, it was about survival. People needed to believe that abundance was possible, even in the darkest of times. Unfortunately, with all this indulgence came excess. The rules of daily life were gone, and people let their impulses take over. Gambling was common, drinking was excessive, and self-control was forgotten. These festivals often turned into what we might call today a free-for-all. And yes, some of this still survives. Think of holiday office parties where people drink too much, or the push to buy, spend, and indulge during the Christmas season. One particularly wild tradition was the election of a Lord of Misrule. This person was in charge of the chaos, encouraging everyone to let go of their inhibitions. For 12 days, the duration of these festivals, the Lord of Misrule could do as he pleased. This idea of a topsy-turvy world is the root of the 12 days of Christmas. But for early Christians, these wild festivals were a serious problem. How could they celebrate Christ while people around them indulged in such pagan customs? They had a choice: reject these traditions or find a way to redeem them. What happened next would forever change. In the early centuries, most Christians refused to celebrate these festivals. They saw them as pagan, indulgent, and completely opposed to the teachings of Christ. After all, how could a celebration filled with drunkenness, gambling, and wild behavior possibly honor God? Take, for example, the story of Pope Gregory in the 4th century. He sent a missionary named Augustine. Augustine was tasked with converting the local people to Christianity. But when he arrived, he quickly realized the challenge ahead of him. The people were deeply attached to their midwinter festivals, and no amount of preaching could convince them to give them up. In his letter, Augustine explained that these festivals were too important to the people. No matter how much he preached, they wouldn't stop celebrating. He asked Pope Gregory for advice. Should he keep trying to persuade them to abandon these traditions? Or was there another way? Pope Gregory's response was both strategic and controversial. He essentially said, "If you can't beat them, join them." Rather than trying to stop these festivals, Gregory suggested transforming them. Instead of celebrating the rebirth of the sun, the people could celebrate the birth of the Son of God. And so, December 25th was chosen as the official date to celebrate Jesus' birth. The reasoning was simple. It was close to the winter solstice, when the pagan festivals were already in full swing. By giving people a Christian reason to celebrate, the church hoped to gradually replace the old traditions with new ones focused on Christ. But there's one question that often comes up. Was Jesus actually born on December 25th? The Bible gives us clues that suggest otherwise. For example, the Gospel of Luke tells us that shepherds were out in the fields watching their flocks at night. In Israel, this would have been unlikely in December. It was too cold, and there was often snow on the hills. Most people agree that Jesus was likely born in the spring or fall, when the weather was mild and shepherds could stay out in the fields. So why December 25th? The date wasn't chosen because it was historically accurate. It was chosen because it fit the church's mission to reach the people where they were. This decision was practical, but it wasn't without controversy. Some early Christians believed it was wrong to mix pagan traditions with the worship of Christ. They feared it would dilute the true message of the gospel, and even today, some Christians feel uneasy about the pagan roots of Christmas. But for the church leaders of the time, the goal was clear: bring people closer to Christ. By assigning a Christian meaning to these celebrations, they hoped to gradually shift the focus away from indulgence and toward worship. This blending of traditions wasn't immediate. It took centuries. At first, many of the old customs continued. The Yule log, the evergreens, and even the feasting remained part of the celebrations. But slowly, these symbols were given new meanings. The Yule log came to represent Christ as the light of the world. Evergreens symbolized eternal life through Jesus, and the 12 days of feasting became associated with the journey of the Magi. The church also introduced new traditions to focus on Christ. The nativity scene, for example, became a way to teach people about Jesus' humble birth. Hymns and carols were written to replace pagan songs. Over time, these new customs began to take root, and the old pagan meanings faded into the background. But the process wasn't always smooth. For centuries, Christmas remained a mix of pagan and Christian elements. Some people fully embraced the Christian meaning, while others continued to hold on to the old ways. This tension between the sacred and the secular is something we still see today. So what does all this mean for us? Can we celebrate Christmas with its pagan roots? And how can we honor the true meaning of Christ's birth in a season so full of distractions? To answer these questions, we need to take a closer look at the journey of Christmas through the centuries and how it became the holiday we know today. In the 4th century, Pope Julius officially declared December 25th as the date for Christ's birth. This wasn't based on biblical evidence, but on a clever calculation. By aligning the celebration of Christ's birth with the already popular winter festivals, the Church could introduce a Christian narrative without demanding people abandon their cherished traditions all at once. But the date carried more meaning than just convenience. December 25th was also linked to the Roman festival of Sol Invictus, the unconquered sun, which celebrated the return of longer days after the winter solstice. For Christians, this symbolism wasn't lost. They reinterpreted it as a celebration of the Son of God, the true light of the world. Over time, December 25th became more than just a date. It became a powerful symbol. In choosing this day, the Church sent a message. Christ's birth represents the light that overcomes darkness, the hope that dispels despair. It was a perfect parallel to the solstice festivals people already celebrated. But the decision to merge these traditions didn't come without conflict. Not everyone agreed with this approach. Some devout Christians believed it was wrong to incorporate pagan elements into the worship of Christ. They argued that the focus should remain solely on biblical teachings, untainted by worldly influences. Throughout history, there were those who rejected Christmas altogether. For example, certain Christian groups in the Middle Ages avoided the celebration, seeing it as too closely tied to pagan customs. Even centuries later, during the Reformation, the Puritans in England and America tried to ban Christmas entirely. To the Puritans, Christmas was nothing more than an excuse for indulgence, drinking, and debauchery. They viewed it as a distraction from the true purpose of faith. For them, the idea of celebrating Christ's birth on December 25th, a date with pagan origins, was unacceptable. This debate over what's sacred and what's secular continues even today. How much of Christmas is about Christ? How much of it is cultural? These questions aren't new. They've been asked for centuries. But despite the debates, the Church's choice of December 25th had a lasting impact. By assigning this day to Christ's birth, they planted a seed, a new narrative that would grow and evolve over time. It allowed the focus to shift from pagan gods to the God who, according to Christian belief, became flesh and dwelled among us. In the centuries that followed, the Church added layers of meaning to Christmas. Hymns and carols told the story of Christ's birth. Traditions like the Nativity play brought the biblical account to life. And December 25th became not just a date, but a season of reflection, gratitude, and faith. It's easy to get caught up in the debates about when Jesus was born or where our traditions come from. But the heart of Christmas isn't about the date. It's about the message. As John 1:5 says, "The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness has not overcome it." That's the truth that Christmas is meant to celebrate. Whether or not December 25th is historically accurate it reminds us of a greater truth, that Christ is the light of the world, bringing hope and salvation to all who believe. That's the story worth celebrating, no matter what day it is. Things came to a head in the 1600s during England's Civil War. When Oliver Cromwell and the Puritans took power, they outlawed Christmas entirely. They saw it as a distraction from true worship and too full of pagan influences. For a time, Christmas was illegal in England and Scotland. Can you imagine that? No Christmas trees, no carols, no feasts. Of course, people didn't give up their traditions so easily. In secret, they still celebrated in the countryside. And after Cromwell's rule ended, the monarchy was restored, and Christmas came back with all its festive glory. By the 19th century, Christmas had evolved again. This is when many of the traditions we know today, Christmas trees, decorations, and gift-giving, became popular. But not everyone agreed. Churches were divided. Should Christmas be embraced as a Christian holiday, or was it too tied to its pagan past? Foreshadowing a deeper spiritual question. Some Christians pushed back, saying we needed to put Christ back in Christmas. Others argued that Christmas had become more of a cultural celebration than a spiritual one. One of the most influential figures in shaping Christmas as we know it was Queen Victoria. Alongside her German-born husband, Prince Albert, she helped introduce new traditions that quickly spread across the Western world. One of the most iconic? The Christmas tree. Albert brought the tradition of the Christmas tree from his homeland of Germany. In his time, families decorated trees with candles, fruits, and small gifts. Under Queen Victoria's reign, the Christmas tree became a centerpiece of holiday celebrations, symbolizing warmth, family, and festivity. Another key tradition that emerged during this period was the Christmas card. In 1843, a man named Sir Henry Cole had the brilliant idea of printing holiday cards to send greetings to loved ones. Before this, people would write lengthy letters, but the simplicity of a pre-made card made it easier and more affordable to connect with friends and family during the holidays. That simple idea took off. By the late 19th century, sending Christmas cards became a beloved tradition. Today, billions of cards are sent around the world every year, spreading joy and connection across distances. But perhaps no 19th century figure influenced Christmas more than Charles Dickens. His novel, A Christmas Carol, published in 1843, captured the spirit of generosity, family, and redemption. It reminded people that Christmas wasn't just about feasting and celebration. It was about, in many ways, Dickens redefined the meaning of Christmas. His story inspired people to focus on giving, especially to the poor and needy, a tradition that continues to this day. In fact, the image of a family gathered around a Christmas dinner, complete with a turkey or goose, comes directly from his book. But Dickens wasn't the only influence shaping Christmas. Across the Atlantic, another figure was gaining popularity: Santa Claus. While the character we know today might seem timeless, his story actually began centuries earlier with Saint Nicholas, a 4th century bishop known for his generosity. The Dutch called him Sinterklaas, and when they settled in New Amsterdam, what we now call New York, they brought his legend with them. Over time, Sinterklaas transformed into Santa Claus, thanks to stories, poems, and illustrations that shaped his modern image. By the late 19th century, Santa Claus had become a central figure in Christmas celebrations, symbolizing joy, generosity, and childhood wonder. His iconic red suit, white beard, and jolly laugh became universally recognized, thanks in part to marketing campaigns and popular media. As the 20th century arrived, Christmas became even more focused on family and children. Gift-giving which had once been a small part of the holiday, took center stage. Advertisers and retailers began to capitalize on the season, creating a commercialized version of Christmas that revolved around toys, decorations, and festive products. By the mid-20th century, the commercialization of Christmas was in full swing. Santa became a mascot for companies. Christmas music dominated the airwaves, and advertisements shaped the way families celebrated. While this brought joy to many, it also raised questions. Was Christmas losing its deeper meaning? But amidst all the glitter and gifts, the message of Christ's birth endured. Churches continued to hold midnight services, families gathered to read the nativity story, and carols like Silent Night reminded people of the holiday's sacred roots. Even as Christmas grew into a global phenomenon, its spiritual heart remained. In the early 1900s, department stores began marketing Christmas as the ultimate season of giving and spending. Santa Claus became a marketing icon, and companies used his cheerful image to sell everything from toys to soda. By the mid-20th century, holiday advertising was everywhere. Christmas wasn't just a holiday, it was a booming industry. Today, Christmas generates billions of dollars in revenue every year. From gifts and decorations to travel and entertainment, the season is big business. But this explosion of consumerism has raised questions for Christians. How do we keep Christ at the center of a holiday so dominated by materialism? For many, the focus of Christmas has shifted. The joy of giving has often been replaced by the pressure to buy. Parents feel obligated to spend beyond their means. Children expect bigger and better gifts each year, and the meaning of the season gets lost in the noise of advertisements and sales. This growing emphasis on stuff has left some feeling empty, as if something is missing. And perhaps it is. After all, the heart of Christmas isn't found in things. It's found in the message of hope and redemption that began in a manger over 2,000 years ago. But the challenge of balancing the sacred and the secular isn't just about consumerism, it's also about culture. Christmas is celebrated in many different ways around the world, and not all of them focus on the birth of Christ. In Japan, for example, Christmas is less about religion and more about romance and consumer culture. Families order fried chicken from KFC as a holiday treat. In parts of Europe, folklore and tradition take center stage, with characters like Krampus and Bafana sharing the stage with Santa Claus. Meanwhile, in countries like India and Nigeria, Christmas is celebrated by Christians in ways that blend local customs with biblical themes. These cultural differences add richness to the holiday, but they also reveal the tension between Christmas as a religious celebration and Christmas as a cultural event. For Christians, this raises an important question. How do we honor the birth of Christ while respecting these diverse traditions? One way Christians around the world are reclaiming the meaning of Christmas is by returning to its spiritual roots. Midnight Mass, Advent wreaths, and Nativity plays are reminders of what the holiday is truly about. These traditions focus on Christ as the center of the celebration, bringing the story of his birth to life. Yet even within the church, the tension remains. For every person who focuses on the nativity, there are others caught up in the glitter of Christmas trees and holiday sales. The balance isn't always easy to find. At its core, Christmas is a story of light shining in the darkness. But in a world filled with distractions, it's easy for that light to be overshadowed. The challenge for Christians today is not to reject the celebrations around us, but to reclaim their meaning. How can we point others to Christ in a season so often focused on everything but Him? As we move closer to understanding the true heart of Christmas, let's remember, It's not just about traditions or even history. It's about the message that began in Bethlehem and still resonates today. God's love breaking through the darkness to bring hope to the world. The heart of Christmas isn't found in its origins or its traditions. It's found in its message. Christmas is about celebrating the moment when God stepped into our world, bringing hope and salvation through the birth of His Son, Jesus Christ. But reclaiming the heart of Christmas doesn't mean rejecting everything modern about the holiday. Instead, it's about finding meaning in the midst of the noise. Christmas trees can remind us of the tree of life. Lights can point us to the light of the world. Even the gifts we exchange can reflect the ultimate gift of God's grace. For many, Christmas is also a time of pain. The bright lights and cheerful songs can feel overwhelming for those who are grieving, lonely, or struggling. This is where the true meaning of Christmas becomes even more powerful. It's a reminder that Christ came into a broken world to bring healing, comfort, and hope. As Christians, we have an opportunity to reach out to those in need, sharing the love of Christ in tangible ways. Whether it's a kind word, a helping hand, or simply being present, these small acts of love can reflect the heart of the gospel. Ultimately, Christmas is an invitation. It's a time to pause, reflect, and reconnect with the story of Jesus' birth. A story that continues to bring hope to billions around the world. It's a moment to shine His light in a dark and distracted world. In Luke 2:10-11, the angel declares, "Do not be afraid. I bring you good news that will cause great joy for all the people. Today, in the town of David, a Savior has been born to you. He is the Messiah, the Lord." This is the message of Christmas. One of joy, hope, and salvation. It's a message the world desperately needs to hear. So this Christmas, let's focus on what truly matters. Let them point you to the deeper meaning behind it all. Let them remind you of the Savior who came to bring light into the darkness and hope into our hearts. Here's where we face a choice. Do we continue with all the traditions, trees, gifts, carols, and feasts, and try to make them about Jesus? Or do we step back and focus only on what the Bible tells us about His birth? You see, the Bible doesn't mention Christmas trees or Santa Claus. It doesn't tell us to celebrate Jesus' birth with big meals or decorations, but it does tell us something important, that Jesus came into the world as a Savior. His birth was humble, simple, and full of meaning. Luke 2:11 says, "For unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, who is Christ the Lord." Christians all over the world celebrate Christmas to honor the birth of Jesus Christ in Bethlehem. There are many different traditions connected to Christmas, and different cultures celebrate in their own unique ways. But what brings everyone together is the historical fact that Jesus was born around 5 BC. The angel who appeared to the shepherds that night said, "I bring you good news that will cause great joy for all the people. Today, in the town of David, a Savior has been born to you. He is the Messiah, the Lord." Luke 2:10-11. We celebrate Christmas because, as the angel said, the birth of Jesus is good news. Good news is something we should celebrate. The angel even said that this news would bring great joy, and that it was for all the people. This means that people all over the world can share in this joy and celebrate this wonderful event together. We celebrate Christmas because, as the angel said, a Savior has been born to you. He is the Messiah, the Lord. The titles the angel gave to Jesus are very important. Jesus is the Savior who rescues us from sin and death. Matthew 1:21. He is also the Messiah, or Christ, A human who fulfills God's promises in the law and the prophets, showing that God is faithful. And he is the Lord, the divine God who came into our world. The Almighty became human. God and man are united forever in an unbreakable bond. Truly, God is with us. When we celebrate Christmas, we celebrate our Savior because we needed to be rescued. We celebrate Christ, in whom all of God's promises are yes and amen, 2 Corinthians 1:20. We celebrate the Lord who, in humility, chose to take on the very nature of a servant for our sake. We give gifts at Christmas because of the indescribable gift God gave us, 2 Corinthians 9:15. We hang lights because the light of the world has come, John 1:4, Isaiah 9:2. We sing carols and join choirs because they express joy, just like Mary, Zacharias, Simeon, and the angels who praised the Lord in poetry, Luke 1:2. We decorate evergreen trees with stars, angels, and tinsel because Jesus brings eternal life, John 4:14, and because stars, angels, and beauty surrounded his birth. When we celebrate Christmas, we celebrate God's love and his willingness to come down to us. In Texas in 1987, a toddler named Jessica McClure fell into an 8-inch wide well casing. She dropped 22 feet and got stuck. When people discovered baby Jessica in the well, they acted immediately. They didn't tell her to climb out on her own, and they didn't just call down words of encouragement. No. They went down to where she was and got her out. Rescuers worked non-stop for 58 hours to save her. In the Garden of Eden, Adam and Eve fell into sin. They dragged all of humanity with them into darkness and death. What did God do? He didn't tell us to figure out how to save ourselves, and he didn't just send words of encouragement from heaven. No. He came down to where we were and saved us. That's what Christmas is about. God coming down to rescue us, doing whatever it took to save us from certain death. When even one person is in a life-threatening situation, we understand what has to be done. When God looked down at our sinful planet, he saw a whole world of people in mortal danger. We celebrate Christmas. Because it was at Christmas time that the rescuer of all mankind came to save us from the hopeless situation we were in. God did not stay in heaven. He came down to where we are. So, what do we do with all this? Should we reject Christmas because of its history? Or should we use it as an opportunity to point people to Jesus? Here's what I believe. It's not about the traditions themselves. It's about our hearts. Are we using this season to truly reflect on Jesus' gift of salvation? Are we sharing his love with others? Or are we caught up in the lights, gifts, and parties? As Christians, we have a choice. We can make Christmas a time to honor Christ, or we can let it become just another worldly celebration. My challenge to you is this. Think about how you celebrate. Pray about it. Ask Jesus what he thinks about your Christmas traditions. And most of all, remember why he came, to bring us hope, peace, and salvation.